All this mudslinging really needs to stop. Why aren't we voting for people acting like big bullies? Well, two wrongs don't make a right, especially with the mean words you type. You say you want world peace, then you tear someone's life to pieces. Open your hearts, open your minds. All we need is peace and love, and then would be all right. Just la 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 la.
You're the only female amongst four guys. You're going to sound better than us. You don't have to warm up. You're fine.
If I have anything to say about it, she does. Moving out with JL Media is back live once again. Hamilton 16 IMAX. Good, rich, quality theaters in a beautiful Hamilton Town Center. Mitch Ross, my man, is joining us. How are you doing, brother?
I'm wonderful, Johnny. How are you doing?
We got a lot to talk about, don't we?
Oh, man.
I'm looking forward to this movie tonight.
I sure do.
To my right, I have a full cavalcade of guests tonight. Mr. David Banks is joining me once again.
I am back. I am here. I am live.
We know David Banks from Indy Drinking Dead as yes. well as Headline News in
yes.
UZ.
Yes, with my lovely co-host, Angie Breyer.
With lovely Angie Breyer. We got to get her up here in Hamilton County
yeah,
soon,
man.
To his right is the lovely and talented Haley Jonay. How you doing, lady?
I am fantastic. How are you?
I'm great. We finally got you on a show up here that, we're not doing it in the bar, so we can get you in.
I know. It's an exclusive club, but I'm excited to make my debut.
And to her right is one Mr. Jeremy Brown. How are you, brother?
I have to be honest. When you said lovely and talented, I really thought you were going to introduce me next.
Oh.
I mean, you nailed it with Haley, but I really thought you were going to say my name after that. And so I'm doing well. It's nice to be back at the Hamilton IMAX. It's been a while, so I'm excited. I'm good.
For those of you who don't know, Jeremy is a comedian of the bunch, not just on the show, but technically you are a comedian.
I am a comedian. I'm a limited comedian. I do have a day job, so I get out whenever I can for stage time and clubs and shows or whatever. And it's good. It's fun. I love doing it. And
you're a local comedian, and you have to have a day job because you eat. there are some out there that are trying to be full-time comedians here doing it locally. And then I worry about them.
Yeah, man. It's you're not going to be able to tell this on a podcast, but I like to eat. I enjoy nourishment. I enjoy food. And being a comedian, some people make it work. I do have a day job, and I do also perform from time to time. So it's a lovely little balance, and I still get to pay my bills and make my wife happy and still be able to perform. So,
well, speaking of performing, what do we got coming up?
Next week at the 10 West Center in Fortville, Indiana, we have a Hee Haw review show. Those of you who know Hee Haw, who grew up on Hee Haw, I'm sure. Do you know about Hee Haw?
Yeah, my parents have well versed me in Hee Haw.
Nice.
They are good people.
So, yeah, we have a Hee Haw review where everyone will be playing characters. They'll be doing skits from Hee Haw. We have a Friday and Saturday night show at 7:30, and it's at 10 West Center in Fortville, Indiana. I also have a Movember show coming up in November and a fundraiser for the Special Olympics coming up at the first of the year, and that date hasn't been settled yet, but there is a Special Olympics fundraiser toward the first of the year. So I've got a few things coming up, and I'm really looking forward to it.
Well, that sounds interesting in itself. And if you need any help with that fundraiser, please let JL know, because we'd love to be a part of it.
Oh, we will. Yeah, we'll get a hold of you.
That is something everybody knows about us. We are real big with charity events. Well, we will help out wherever we can.
That's awesome. My wife actually sits on the board for the Hamilton County Disabilities Association, so they decided to do that this year, and she's putting together a show and decided to have her favorite comedian on the show.
Oh, and you too? Okay, that's very good.
No, I gave her someone else's name, so it's never going to be me. But that's what's coming up, and I've got a lot of little bitty things going on here and there, so just having a good time and having a blast doing it.
Mitch, I don't know if you have noticed this evening, but Jeremy and I are both fans of Screen Tap.
I'm glad to see that.
Tell us about Screen Tap right here at Hamilton 16 IMAX.
Oh, well, we have a lovely little bar underneath our stairwell over there. We have beer and wine on tap and all your favorite craft brews in a bottle. You can take your beer into your show as long as it's PG-13 or R. After 8 o'clock, you can take it into any show. So we do have a limit. We ask people to drink responsibly, but not too responsibly. Please buy some beer.
I'm out.
Now, Haley, do you have something coming up before we get started with the movie?
I am currently working on my second album, which is very exciting. And I have a gig in Greenfield, Indiana on October 8th at Riley Festival.
Riley Festival?
Yeah, at 5:45. So that should be cool. Hometown show.
Now, we talked about this on an episode of Brother Brother Beercast.
Yeah, throwback. Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about Riley Festival.
Riley Festival is, I don't want to, it's like kind of Greenfield's like main event. It's like the biggest thing that they put on throughout the year. And I've been going to it since I was like 3. And so now to perform there, it's kind of cool. It's kind of a lot of nostalgia and realization of a lot of dreams that I've had since I was a kid. So it's cool.
Very nice.
Congratulations. Hey,
thank you.
That's awesome.
Is there a name for the, or a title for the new album?
No, that's a secret. But honestly, it's not even a secret because I haven't come up with it yet. But let's just be real. But yeah.
Deepwater Horizon is why we are here tonight at Hamilton 69 Match. I can't even get all that out. I swear, I like Screen Tap a lot.
Say it slowly.
It is a nice bar they have over here. I came and set up early because there was a storm rolling in. You can't tell by the crowd that is here because the place is packed.
There is a lot. It's like a people watcher's dream in here. There is a lot of people in here.
Absolutely.
Deepwater Horizon is why we are here at Hamilton 16 IMAX. That's what I was trying to say.
There you go.
I
okay.
got it all out
You got
there.
It that time.
What do we know about Deepwater, the film?
All right, well, I promised I would come prepared this week, so I know everything about offshore well drilling and the production of shale in the United States oil industry. Deepwater Horizon is about the Deepwater Horizon accident that happened in the Gulf of Mexico with the oil well explosion. It stars Mark Wahlberg, Kurt Russell, Gina Rodriguez, new to the screen star, but not to the small screen. She plays Jane the Virgin on TV. It's directed by Peter Berg, who also did The Kingdom a few years back, the film version of Friday Night Lights, and a movie I really like with The Rock called The Rundown.
Oh, yes.
Yes,
with Scott Williams.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That movie's awesome.
That's
with
the best.
Stifler.
Yeah, it's
with
very
Stifler.
Funny.
Yeah. Everybody knows Stifler. Well, Stifler. Haley may not know Stifler.
Yeah,
you we're know
not gonna, we are not going to do a bunch of young jokes. I promise you, Haley. We will not do that.
No, it's all good. I'm used to it.
Hey, I'm a comedian. I'm going to do a bunch of young jokes. Okay, I don't know what Johnny's going to do. But,
He also did Lone Survivor, Peter Berg, with Mark Wahlberg.
Oh, that's correct.
Yeah. So this is our
that's
second,
a good movie too.
Yeah, this is our second movie together.
Isn't it?
Kurt Russell's in this as well as Kate
John
Hudson,
Malkovich.
Correct?
John Malkovich.
Yeah,
Kate Hudson's in it as
yeah,
well.
Kate
they're
Hudson
fans.
It,
so
yeah.
This is their first one together. That's going to be interesting. Now, Deepwater Horizon was an actual rig. This is based on a true story. Do we know how true to Hollywood they're going to be?
Well, I don't know. I've heard from our.
So you're our end guy. So we expect you to know all the ends of this stuff. You know.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
Come on, Mitch, get it together.
What the kids have told me about the movie is that the action sequences in this film. The eruption of the oil well and all that stuff is tremendously exciting.
Oh wow!
So they said it's some of the coolest stuff they've seen on screen in a long time, and I was surprised to hear that coming from 16-year-old kids. So that tells me that it actually is probably pretty cool.
Yeah. I
mean,
they're pretty skeptical. They're pretty critical about a lot of things like special effects or whatever. So if they're saying that,
oh yeah, man, they get the best of the best from the second they're born now.
Right.
So,
yeah.
So if they say something's cool, it's probably cool.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
It might not be good, but it'll be cool.
It'll be cool. Right.
Yeah. Accurate. I can attest to that.
Well, I can't imagine what it would be like to be on the actual rig when it went up. I mean, it had to be terrifying. It was just before 10 o'clock at night, April 20th, 2010, I believe it was.
Well, I mean, the thing is, man, those guys are out there in the middle of nowhere. Like, the ocean is huge. My dad was in the Navy, and he took me out on a ship once, And you just don't understand how big the water is until you're on a giant vessel made out of iron and steel, and the waves are still above the towers, the superstructure of the building. Like, I can't imagine being out there all by yourself, like, jumping, you know, 30 stories or whatever into the water. That's crazy.
I remember one time I was on Lake Michigan, and we were, like, a mile away from the shore, and I was so scared I almost peed myself. And because you couldn't see, it's that big, you couldn't see land. It was almost like, I can't imagine being on an oil rig, like you said, in the middle of nowhere, where the closest place of land is, you know, 2 hours away or whatever. And then having that happen, it's just amazing to me.
Yeah, man, that's crazy. And plus, that it can't explode. It's oil.
Yeah. Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, you're sitting on a big flammable structure.
Right.
Right.
I believe I read that the ships that were going to fight the fire, the thing caught on fire and burned for 2 days before it finally sank. And I believe from what I read, it took a ship 10 hours to get there.
Man.
Yeah, I read that they actually could see the explosion 40 miles away.
Yes.
Like it was still burning.
Oh, I imagine. Yeah. That's something that big and something, yeah.
Now, the people called it the BP oil spill. That's the name it got. But BP actually ran the rig. It was leased from a different company. Of course, it was Korean made. I think in 2009, it got a couple of world records for deep water drilling before they moved it and took it over. Before it happened in 2010, of course. They were, it was leased through, or leased to BP from 2001 till 2013. See, I'm just doing all this from memory. I'm not sure where I'm going with it at all. But
I'm highly impressed right now.
Yeah.
Mark,
it had the highest. It held the record for the deepest drilling.
Yes.
Yeah, but after you spill all of that, it kind of makes that record kind of like go to the wayside, I would think.
It was an unavoidable thing, is what it was. Of course, and BP is getting all the fallback from it, but it was a design flaw. It was made in South Korea by Honda, believe it or not.
Is BP going to be a sponsor of this show?
Not yet.
I feel we're defending them quite valiantly.
Well, I really just got into, you know, what really happened with it. You know, I would read the headlines and see the news videos and everything, and everybody was talking about how bad it was and BP this and BP that, and found out there's a lot more to it than just BP.
That seems to be a common theme, though, with media coverage of, like, big events like that. Like, Sometimes the details just kind of get left to the wayside, I feel like.
Truncated down to sound bites.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right, or yeah, whatever the media wants to let you, you know, it's like it's an unavoidable flaw. It couldn't have been. There had to be some way to avoid that flaw.
Exactly.
I mean, how about maybe not make it North Korea? How about some, you know, maybe somewhere more technically advanced?
Well, in September of 2009 is when it got the depth record, 35,000 feet.
That's amazing.
Man, that's amazing. That's crazy. Almost 7 miles.
Yeah.
That's nuts, dude.
Wow.
That's insane.
I don't think I've ever walked 35,000 feet in my life total. I mean, if you added it all up, I either ride a bike or I drive. You know,
They were only at 4,100 feet. Yeah, 4,100 feet when the incident happened.
Wow.
Wow. The Marianas Trench is the deepest water in the world, and that's that's just over 7 miles. So that's like as deep as the Marianas Trench. That's crazy, man. That's kind of neat. Yeah. I mean, you know.
That's wicked. That is wild. How did Wahlberg get involved in this? Anybody know? Did Berg bring him in from Lone Survivor and just work with him before?
I think, I know I read that Mark wanted to do another project with Peter Berg because he kind of, the flow went so well on Lone Survivor. I mean, he really liked the film, and I think he saw the story, the script was out there, and he just wanted to be a part of it, you know?
Well, Peter Berg is a much better director than he is an actor. Yeah. He's been in some good stuff. I'm still going to defend Copland to this day because I thought it was a good movie.
Sylvester Stallone?
Go ahead and do it.
I love Copland, man.
Yeah.
And Robert De Niro. And
oh, absolutely. He's all-star, man.
Yeah, I loved it. I loved it.
Hamilton 69 Max is where we're doing this. Goodrich Quality Theaters, Hamilton Town Center. We do, I guess, the premieres each month. However, we are doing it more for the rest of the year.
Nice.
Hamilton Town Center. Mitch.
Yes, sir.
What are we doing next, man? I need to talk to you about this. I don't even know what we're doing next month.
Next month is Doctor Strange, right?
November 4th is Doctor Strange.
That's November 5th. Let's see. What do we got in October?
Now we're going to have to check the paperwork and come back, aren't we?
We'll have to check.
Is that the one with The Rock in it where he plays a cartoon? Is that the one you're doing? Can I be back on the podcast if that's one you're doing?
Tooth Fairy 2.
Oh, Lord, please don't. No. Oh, God.
We'll have to check on that and see, because I've got a list and I don't remember. The dates were so off.
Yeah,
that's why
I'll have to take
shows.
A look here. But, yeah, there's some decent stuff coming up in October, so I'm looking forward to some of the flicks that we've got coming.
No, we'll get in for a couple. Well, we've got several more before the end of the year. We know this. Now, there's a lot of, I guess, disaster movies that they've done over the years.
There's been a ton, man.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we could sit here and name them all day, but before we start doing that, talking about the ones we love, what about the ones that are based on actual events? Do we know those?
I love movies that are based on actual events. True story movies are my favorite types of movies.
Here's a question. Would you put Titanic in that category?
You just stole. I was literally
you
just
thinking about that.
Yeah.
I mean, would you put Titanic in that?
No, I would. Yeah.
Okay.
Because it actually happened. I mean, listen. You go when you went to the movie theater to watch Titanic. Everyone knows the ending of Titanic, right? I mean, the ship sinks.
Yeah.
Oh, spoiler alert.
All right. I think I should have said spoiler alert first. So I think in any true story movie, people have either read about it, they know about it in history or whatever. I think what I like true stories or documentaries or whatever movies is like the story building up to what happened and the fact that Hollywood can capture in an actor that wasn't there, had no part of whatever was going on, Hollywood can capture the emotion and whatever was going on in the situation with that actor. Like, I think it's easy to make up any story. Like, I could make up a story, hey, me and Johnny were driving down the road and blah, blah, this or whatever, and make it believable. But when people know what happened and they can watch that on a screen and then be taken back to what happened and make it, you know, obviously it's believable because it happened. But to the emotion and everything that is captured, like any type of movie that's true, I like watching those because I wasn't there. I knew what happened, but I didn't know the total impact and the actors. That's what brings it to me.
We're not going to mention Benghazi then, are we? Because
I mean, but would
13
that be,
Hours was a deep movie.
Would that be considered a disaster flick?
Because
I just mentioned Titanic, and then you have like World Trade Center. The yeah. Oliver Stone movie with Nick Cage.
Right.
And then you had United 93. And then you...
Both of those are really good movies.
Yeah, they're really good. And then on the flip side of that, you have Armageddon.
Yeah, that's not... Yeah, that's a disaster flick, I guess. But it's not... Well, nothing really happens, does it? I mean...
It's like natural disaster or...
Deep Impact.
Right.
You know.
That's a true story. Those miners saved our lives.
Right, yes.
We could, there are a couple of acting disasters. We
Bruce
could get
Willis
into.
Sacrificed himself for us.
But I understand what you're saying, Jeremy. I mean, that can get very emotional. Believe it or not, I saw The Light, the Hank Williams story.
Oh, yeah.
For the first time just last week. And I knew the story. I was a big fan.
All right.
Is that a disaster flick?
I had a tear in my eye.
Oh.
Not a tear in my beer, a tear in my eye.
I actually know that song.
That's a good thing.
I actually know that song. I can't believe I do, but I do.
So what are some of the biggest disaster films that have been out? We know Titanic was huge.
Well, we were talking about them a little bit earlier. Yeah. Towering Inferno, Poseidon Adventure, Earthquake. There was in the early 90s, there was the year of the two volcano movies.
Oh.
Right? We had Volcano, one of them with Pierce Brosnan, and the other one with...
Tommy Lee Jones.
Hanks.
Tommy Lee Jones, right. And that was... What was that called? Saint...
Oh, something Peak.
Oh, yeah. Dante's Peak.
Dante's Peak.
Yeah.
Not a movie about a receding hairline, but an erupting mountain.
Well, there are a lot of them that are, you know, are recent. Of course, not based on true stories. We had San Andreas with The Rock.
Yeah.
We mentioned The Rock.
Yeah.
We had 2012 that come out a few years back.
Yes.
With, oh boy, yeah.
Hell, you just had Independence Day, too.
We did.
Yeah. If you want to count that.
We had the Day After Tomorrow.
Day After Tomorrow was another one? Yeah. Cusack, John Cusack.
John Cusack,
2012,
that's right.
There we go.
Day After Tomorrow has like my funniest, stupidest movie gag ever, where everybody has to run faster than the speed of cold.
Yeah.
Like they're trying to outrun like cold. Like, how do you do that? Is that a thing?
I would just freeze.
It never works in the winter
for
me.
I would just freeze. I would just, I ain't outrunning nothing. I ain't outrunning anything.
I put on my tennis shoes before I run to my car in the winter. My wife's like, what are you doing? We can do this, honey. We can do this together. We can run faster than the speed of cold.
If Jake Gyllenhaal could do it, we all can
That's
do
right.
it.
I grew up in the Deep South. I don't know if you guys knew this about me.
No, we couldn't.
To this day, I will still not go outside without house slippers on. At least to get the paper in the morning, I have house slippers. Normally, just walking around the house, I'll have house slippers on. Okay. Jeremy's pointing at people over here. I thought that was a cop looking at him, but security is not. Security's not coming. Now, people are laughing at him out in the crowd.
I actually work with that lady. She's a sweet lady. She's here with her husband watching the movie. Good for her. They're like 80 years old. They're out on a...
He's just like, sorry,
she's not 80 what? Years old. She's, no. she's
well, we know like, she's not at home listening live, so he's all right.
No, she's not going to listen to this. I actually work with her. She's her husband just had back surgery, and they're coming out to see a movie.
Okay, and they're going to come speak to you like everybody does. You ever notice that there's a full radio show going on, and people just, hi, what are you doing? We're gonna let them talk for a minute. You go right ahead. Disaster films. Hamilton 16 IMAX is where we're doing this live. Jeremy Brown has some fans up here talking to him. Good, rich, quality theaters, Hamilton Town Center.
This is a lovely facility here, Mitch. I'm not lying, man. I swear, if you had Netflix showing here, I would not leave. I would get mail here.
I would have to go resident. Fire stick. If you
Thank
had
you. I built it with my own two hands.
Wow.
We need a fire stick theater. One of your theaters need to be a fire stick theater, and I'd be here every day.
All right.
I think that's a good idea. Throwbacks.
We got Flashback Cinema. Sundays and Wednesdays at 2 and 7 p.m. This week is Batman from 1989 with Jack Nicholson and Michael Keaton.
I saw that on the poster, and I am recording Sunday and Wednesday this week. I'm going to miss Batman. I was looking forward to it.
Oh, man. It's going to be a lot of fun. We also have the original Wizard of Oz coming up on October 9th.
Ooh, that's cute. Cool.
Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, 1971.
Ooh. Wow.
Psycho, 1960 on October 23rd, and the original version of Halloween, John Carpenter's classic.
I am happy right now.
On October 30th
this is a really
and November
stellar lineup.
2nd. So yeah, this is a really good lineup. We've been doing this this is our second season this fall, and we started it this summer, but we're having a lot of fun bringing back the classic movies, and people seem to be really enjoying it.
For
so
sure.
we're stoked to have it on that program on our schedule.
There's no way I'm missing Psycho and Halloween this year. I'll get to see it here, without a doubt. You know what's coming up first of next year? Why I have you on the subject with Flashbacks.
I do not have the next Flashback season coming up, but we've got all kinds of cool stuff going on. If we get a chance, we should talk about the Met Opera. We've got Lights Up, Sound Down for those people out there in the special needs community who have kids who... have sensory sensitivities.
Uh-huh.
We do a show once a month at 10 a.m. This one on October 1st is Storks. We've got one in November for Trolls, one in December for Moana. And basically, we turn the audio down a little bit. We turn the lights up so that the young kids with sensory issues, like my daughter's autistic, so she has to wear headphones and stuff when she watches movies, so that those kids can be a little bit more comfortable. It is sponsored by our partners at West Point Financial, and you can go to our website and look up Lights Up, Sound Down to see how you can get tickets.
I like that.
That's
Mitch,
fantastic.
You have a daughter on autism spectrum?
I do.
My wife is the autism specialist for Hamilton South Asian Schools.
What's your wife's name?
Leslie Brown.
I might have met Leslie Brown.
Probably. She's, for... All Hamilton Southeastern School, she's the specialist in autism.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thank her for me.
So we've talked about that before and how much she thinks that's cool that the lights are, it's not so loud or whatever because a lot of obviously have sensory issues or whatever. So it's a very cool thing you do. So she appreciates it as well. So.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah, I'm glad we're able to do it. West Point Financial actually is a sponsor of that event, so
nice.
they give away some tickets for those events. So you know, if there's anybody out there who's looking to do that, I strongly recommend going to our website or theirs. But it's a personal issue to me, but I'm very glad as a business manager that we're able to do that for the community as well.
Good on you.
We appreciate it. Thank you.
Shout out to West Point Financial.
Yes, sir.
There we go. Miss Haley.
Yes.
Do you have a favorite disaster movie?
Well, because we brought up Titanic, and I know this is pretty stereotypical maybe for an 18-year-old girl, but I'm going to have to go with Titanic.
Oh.
It really hits me in the feels. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry.
Rose. So stupid, Rose.
I'm the king of the world.
Because of the love story, right?
I mean, yeah, that's part of it, but I think it's just, I don't know. It's a good movie. I'm not sorry. It's a good movie.
Man, that movie got on my nerves. I am not lying.
Why?
It was... I remember that movie, and I'm about to tell you my age right now because okay. I was 17 when that movie came out in December of 97, and I will never forget a senior year of high school. That's all I heard every day from these girls.
Celine Dion.
That too. I got tired of that song. But like these high school girls were coming every day. Oh, my God, I just seen Titanic. Oh, my God, Leonardo this, Leonardo that. The following week, the same thing. I probably heard it for about a good month.
Well,
and
I mean,
it was nothing but women, and I was like, what? and then I saw the movie. I'm like, okay.
But you were there at like the height of its hype, and like, so I'm sure you were just like really oversaturated.
Insane. It was insane.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
So I feel like I've just like not been in that oversaturated environment with it.
So now
I'm just kind of like, oh, I can appreciate that.
And then and then that song was on heavy rotation, no matter what radio station you listen to. I mean, you could listen to the hip hop station. They would just insert Celine Dion in between P. Diddy and Tupac, you know.
You were 17 or 18 when that movie came out?
Yes. Yeah, it was December
97. You know that Johnny was 17 when the ship sank. So
wow.
Man. Comedy. That's what we're doing here. We're telling jokes, people.
Oh, my goodness. See, it's the old jokes now, Haley. It's just not the young ones. I thought Titanic was a good movie.
It was all right.
I enjoyed it.
It got a lot more sad for me when I read that there was no Rose or Jack. They were just a story that was thrown in there. I was kind of hoping it was loosely based on someone.
That's
but
a thing.
No.
I didn't feel sorry for Rose or Jack. I felt sorry for that band. They just played till the ship went down. I feel sorry for them dudes.
You know what's interesting about that movie is James Cameron had been kind of off the radar for a little while. He had done True Lies. Obviously, T2 at the time was the biggest movie of all time until Jurassic Park came out. And then he was kind of quiet for a while, and he started production on this movie, and it took him a long time to make,
and it was way
over budget.
Yeah.
But some of the details they paid attention to in that movie are amazing.
For sure.
Like... The china that people are eating off of, they actually found the prints of that china.
They replicated it.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Replicated it down to the name of the manufacturer and the year on the back of the plates and
that's
stuff.
That's insane.
That's very cool.
I mean, that's you have to respect, like, at least the detail and the labor of love that film was for them. You know, I'm like most, you know, I was around that same age, man, and it was just like everywhere, and you know, girls were like, "Are you gonna cut your hair like Leo?"
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm gonna shave my head.
And along with that, with that movie, you have to respect, because I believe opening weekend it only made about $25 million.
For
the opening weekend, and it just grew because that's how they got their money on the comeback.
Well, it's so long too. That's the thing that people don't realize about movie theaters is a movie that can play six times a day will always make more money than a show that can only play four. So, I mean, not always, you know.
That movie was long, man.
But it's a long movie. So, you know, movie theaters only had two or three prints of it could only play nine shows a day. And that really affects things. So it had to have legs in order to make the money. But I think it was like the number one movie in America for like 21 weeks or something crazy like that.
I remember
I'm making stuff
no,
up.
No.
It was
you're
a long
right.
time.
You're right. It was number one, and I believe it was Leonardo DiCaprio's next movie, which was The Man in the Iron Mask, who took it, who dethroned it. And I believe that came out maybe February or March of 98.
You're kidding me. That one took it out?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. All so
right. Jeremy, you're a little bit older than Jonay.
Hmm?
Jeremy is a little bit older than Haley. And now that he's back, I'm going to ask him a question. Is those IPAs you're drinking? What are you drinking down there?
It's called a dirty. It's like an old school term for a person that has no dad.
Okay.
Can I say it? I don't know. It's like but you get it. Yeah, I danced around it. You get it. But it's an Irish
Scottish ale.
Scottish ale. Yes, yeah. And it's
just
amazing.
Just called the Jon Snow.
There we go.
I was about to throw you a question. I looked down there and you were in the bathroom. I'm like, okay.
I told Haley, I said, thanks for letting me sit on the end because I got a bladder the size of a hamster's. So I'm going to be, one goes in and two comes out. So thanks for letting me sit on the end. I don't want to walk around.
But the heart of a lion. Now, you're a little bit older than Haley. Do you have a favorite disaster movie?
Ishtar? Is that? Oh, no. I see what you're saying. I really like Armageddon, or not Armageddon, Independence Day.
The first one?
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, I haven't even seen the second one. As far as I'm concerned, that doesn't exist. oh, God, there's so many. I probably that one. It's like I like the whole thing about everyone coming together to prevent a, for a common cause. And even though it is fictional... I like the whole idea behind that. And
what kind of movies do you and Miss Leslie enjoy?
Obviously comedies. Like you said, I love biographic movies. I like Walk the Line with the Johnny Cash story.
Sure.
I like Jersey Boys a lot.
Oh.
Me and Leslie have been to see the play two or three times. I actually went to go see. The movie a couple times.
Uh-huh.
And I just really like true stories about people like Johnny Cash or Ray. I love the movie Ray.
That was a great one. Yeah.
About Ray Charles. So, and we enjoy, at any given time, Leslie can come home and I'm probably watching a movie on TV. And I usually watch movies like 10 or 12 times so I can quote them later on or just like something in the back of my mind or whatever. If I see a good movie, there's no...
What about This Is Your Life, JoJo Dancer? You remember that one?
Richard Pryor?
It's a Richard Pryor
movie. Yeah, it's Richard Pryor. Yeah. Isn't that about...
It's based off his life.
It's supposed to be loosely on his life, yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's pretty... It's, you know, years ago.
It's been years since I've seen that, but yeah.
You said it's a real good movie. I had no idea what hadn't came to mind. I hadn't thought of it in years. But,
yeah. Wow, yeah. I hadn't thought of that movie in... Yeah.
Look out, Fire Stick. Here we come. We got to find it somewhere.
The ones I liked I'm sorry, Johnny. Go ahead.
Go right ahead, brother.
I was just going to say, did you see Straight Outta Compton or Get On Up? Either of those?
Yeah, I saw Straight Outta Compton. I actually just saw that here a few weeks ago. I finally watched it at home, and I lived that. That was my. You know what I mean? I didn't live straight out, but I like. That was my.
He was a gangster, boy. I'm telling you.
Like, I know you can't tell by looking at me. I'm kind of a G. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Lowercase.
I'm a bit of a G. Lowercase G.
Certified.
Ever since I was a lowercase. Okay. Anyway.
See.
There it is.
So I mean, but I grew up with that music, and I saw the whole. From start to finish, where they were nothing, and then they all started branching out to make like Aftermath and all these other different record labels. So I really, really enjoyed that, and I think they did a really good job of it.
I thought it was an incredible movie. Like
I agree,
it was
one of my favorite movies of the year. Honestly, it was outstanding.
Yeah. And I'm like you, I lived through that.
Oh
you
yeah,
know?
I
remember all of them when. When they had the Jerry Curl rocking the Adidas sweatsuits and
the
everything.
Oakland Raiders gear
Oakland,
and yeah,
you
yeah.
know the big thick
the Compton
chains
hats
and stuff.
And yeah,
man, I lived yeah.
And who knew what kind of actor Ice Cube was going to turn into? Because I lived through it too, but I never pictured him in film. You know, just from those days. You know, he was a gangster that I didn't want to be in the same room with.
He was
a pretty good actor.
How much has he evolved? How much is he?
That's just it. Yeah,
he was
well,
one
musically
of,
or
Ice Cube and Dr. Dre have done. Amazing how what they've done
out of that group.
Yeah.
Out of
Dr. Dre's a billionaire.
He is.
He's not. I don't mean that metaphorically. He's literally a millionaire.
Like, he's got a lot of money.
He sold beats for $1.5 billion or something crazy like that.
With a billionaire. Yeah.
Billionaire.
Right, he's got a few bucks. He's a billionaire. Right.
Which I don't get, because I've had two pairs of beats, and I don't understand the attraction. Both of them tore up on me. They're horrible.
So what's really? What's your preferred headphone?
The ones you're using.
Yeah, right now. The ones we're all wearing.
I'm glad you asked that question, Miss Haley, because I can make an announcement on this show that has not been made yet.
Oh, the exclusive.
Absolutely. I have several sponsors through Brother Beercast, and most people know that JL Media is doing 9 shows now. One of my sponsors from Brother Beercast is Sam Ash Music Stores. They've been sponsoring me for 2 years now, 2.5 years. They just doubled down on me today. JL Media is now taking on Sam Ash as a sponsor, so they are covering all the shows.
That's awesome.
And that's why I got a whole lot of new gear.
Nice.
So basically, congratulations.
Everything that Sam Ash sells is my favorite product.
Yep.
All right.
Congratulations.
Really, the Samson that we're using Samson headphones, and they've outlasted my Beats by tenfold already. And sound quality, I think they're just as good. So,
and all the people on the podcast tonight will be getting a brand new set of Samson headphones.
You get headphones.
Everybody gets headphones.
Courtesy of Sam.
No, not everybody, but if everyone would now look under your chairs, somebody's going on with a set.
Don't tease me, Johnny. Don't tease me.
As well as ASG Unlimited, our printing company, Sam Ash is now a sponsor of JL Media today. So,
congratulations. That's incredible.
Nice. That's awesome.
That's awesome.
Check them out.
Thank you, Sam Ash.
Tell them that Johnny sent you, and they're going to cut you a great deal, just like ASG will. Thank you for that lead-in. That was wonderful.
Oh, yeah. Always.
Hamilton 16IMAX is where we're doing it live. It's movie night with JL Media. Among other things, tonight we are discussing Deepwater Horizon with Mark Wahlberg. You got a favorite Mark Wahlberg movie, Mitch?
The one where he talks like this.
all of them.
Mark Wahlberg. I really like Mark Wahlberg. I think he's cool, and he makes.
Oh, he's
good
the best.
Movies. I was just watching The Shooter the other day. Oh, yeah. I love that movie, man.
Yeah, it was a good movie.
Did you see? Was it Four Brothers? Was that the name of it?
The what?
Four Brothers. Yeah,
that's a great movie.
Yeah.
I thought he was great in that.
Four Brothers is the best. He just doesn't care in that movie. He has no. He gives zero cares in that movie.
Well, I think it's great when he's hiding in the bathroom, you know, and a tear comes to his eyes when he's thinking about his mom. But, you know, my favorite song of all time comes on the radio. It plays behind him as he's crying. So that's a soft spot for me.
What song is that?
The old doo-wop song, I Wish It Would Rain.
That it would rain.
See, Jeremy's got it right. He ain't got the right. Yeah, he's got it. He's not on note there, but he's got it. That's the song, brother.
I thought I did fairly well. Thanks for, my temptations.
Much love to Jeremy Brown, the comedian, ladies and gentlemen, not the singer. That's Miss Haley beside him.
Haley, how do we hear your music?
Oh, iTunes, Spotify, HaleyJonay.com. It's pretty much everywhere. The music is distributed online, yeah.
Global.
And you can search Brother Brother Beercast.
Yeah, Mitch, maybe you just need to look harder, Mitch.
I'm sorry.
She has a recent episode on Brother Brother Beercast as well.
I do. That was a lot of fun.
So the Brother Brother Beercast is a blast.
Jeremy's been a past guest as well.
Cool.
It went... He fed me PBRs nonstop. I don't know if it went the same way for you. But
no.
No.
No. Okay.
I hope not.
And her dad was sitting there, too, so I was on my best behavior.
What about him? Did he partake in any?
I think that day I had maybe I had one before they got there, and I wasn't doing much heavy drinking because I was just meeting her. And
right.
She's underage, and, I didn't want to give off a bad impression.
Yeah, he just steadily kept just bringing him to me, so.
Yeah, we're
and it was the first time you met me, too, so.
We're middle-aged men.
Right. There you go.
I can't get arrested if you sneak a drink. You
know I'm a middle-aged man. Yeah, I don't know about
Man, I hope this is the middle. I hope I'm not, 75% done.
What's going on with you, man? You were working on some music over there. You were doing a little writing.
Right now, I'm working on a screenplay with a friend of mine, and we're We're doing a science fiction movie. So I'm looking forward to, we've got a, we just passed the halfway point today. We're at about 50 pages. So once we get to 90 or 100, we're going to sit back and see what we've got and start refining it. I'm really excited about it.
Okay, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to do something locally, or are you going to send it off to someone?
I'm gonna get it made into a movie. I think it's good. So I'm super excited. I mean, I'm not going to quit my day job. You know what I mean?
But you don't want to do that.
So you're saying we could be doing movie night with JL Media premiering your movie.
Ooh.
You know, Haley was talking about like going in and performing in front of her home audience. It would be cool if my movie was on movie night someday. That'd be neat.
Wow.
But we'll
I think
see.
It'd be great.
Haley could do the soundtrack.
Yeah.
That's there right.
You, wow.
I got you. Yeah.
I could be like a dead carcass or a body or something. <in the movie>. I can lay motionless really well. I mean, you know, it's like...
How would that be credited in the end credits? I mean,
dead body, Jeremy dead Brown,
man floating in pool,
right? Yeah,
I can always be the token black guy. If you want me to,
and that would be credited as token black guy.
Token black guy, you can just, yeah, token black guy, ass token right. black guy.
They're
yeah,
always I'll, the first to die that. In any sure, horror movie. Not? So, but this yeah. is science this fiction, is science so you fiction. May make it to the end.
Not in this one. I made it a point that that's not the case in this movie.
No, oh, atta boy.
So I can't be a Will Smith. All right,
Mitch is breaking barriers. Be a survivor. Breaking barriers.
Hamilton 16 IMAX is where it's getting out of hand. Movie night with JL Media is what we're doing tonight. Is what we're doing tonight. Deepwater Horizon is what we're talking about. In the 70s, there was like a whole string of disaster films that come out. You did all your airport movies. Remember those? Airport 71,
oh,
Airport
yeah.
73.
Sure.
I mean, how many of those did they do? You remember those, Jeremy?
Yeah, I do. A little bit, yeah.
You had the Towering Inferno. You had Poseidon Adventure came out. I'm not sure what year that was.
What was the year that the Mount St. Helens movie came out with... I can't remember his name. He was an older guy, and he refused to move up from his house. It was when the Mount St. Helens, like 81, I think, maybe a little
oh,
later
yeah.
than the 70s.
I remember that. What is that called? Is it called Mount St. Helens?
I think so, but there was an actor, and he refused to leave his home. They were trying to evacuate everyone because, of course, the thing was getting ready to blow.
Right.
And I think it was 80 or 81 when it blew, but he refused to leave his home. And I if I want to say that
it had to be 81 because 81 I know Mount St. Helens erupted in
who
May
was the
80.
Main guy in there? That
it was St. Helens, and it was starring Art Carney.
Art Carney, yes, that's the guy. Yep. And he refused. He was like this old curmudgeon that I've lived here all my life. You know what I mean? This is my house, and I'm not leaving. I think it's been a while, but I think he ended up like. Getting buried by ash and all
yeah.
this other stuff and like
I remember it scaring the crap out of me. I was 4 years old and like I was can I say the C word on your show, Johnny?
I prefer you didn't, but actually you're a sponsor, so is your show. But.
I'm sorry. It scared the heck out of me. And because I was five years old.
Now I'm
I think.
Wondering what C word you're referring to.
I think that's kind of crap that he couldn't say the C word oh, yeah. on the show.
That word's okay.
Okay, all right, might be. But yeah, I just remember they showed all these people getting covered in ash and all this stuff, and I remember that old man, and that was terrifying.
I've never seen that film.
I was like nine years old, and I just remembered, is it gonna get here, Mom? And I remember asking my parents literally, is it gonna? And they're like, no, it's like on the other side of the country, you know. It's like, but I was scared to death when that thing blew, because I was like. I could have swore it was going to get to us. And
well, yeah, when you're little like that, you have, like, no context for what distance is. The ash will cover more than 500 miles. And you're like, 500 miles, we're all going to die.
Right, yeah.
Like, this is happening. We're moving out. We're getting on a boat.
Getting on a boat.
Are there any disaster movies coming up that you know of?
No, you know, I don't think there's anything coming up that I can remember on the schedule for the winter frame anyway. They usually save a lot of that stuff for the summer, though.
Right.
So
this would be kind of late for it to come out, for Deepwater to be coming out, wouldn't it? As a summer movie?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, this is also kind of a true story. Like, you start to get your dramas, like September, October going, and then you get all your, like, really heavy-hitting, like, you know, Oscar award-winning movies in November and December,
yeah.
along mm-hmm. with all your, like, kids' movies, you know. reindeer dancing with elves and singing rock songs or whatever it's going to be this year.
Nice.
I never really realized there was like a formula to when movies, like genre.
There always is.
Oh, absolutely. It's all based around when kids are out of school, because that's how we make our money.
It's like
selling
after
popcorn.
Like after Christmas until maybe about May, you have like a little dead period of movies. And once spring hits, you got all the start of the summer blockbusters is what they call it. And then it carries that until maybe August. And then you have a little dry period, and then they get ready for the Oscars movies to come out. You see all these little independent films start coming out. And then you have your Christmas movies, which are usually big holiday movies. And then you roll into Oscar season, and there you go. It starts like a rotation.
I feel like I've always been aware of it, but like never put really words to it. So it's kind of cool to like see how that works. That's awesome.
Yeah, I never did think of it either. Here, I have a question, Johnny. What's your guilty pleasure movie, Johnny? Like, we can go around the table with this. What's your movie?
I've got a couple of them, man. I had people picking at me here recently just because of this. Some friends of ours over at Cult Cinema Cavalcade, Cullen and Brandon over there, they did an episode with the movie Rhinestone, Dolly Parton, Sylvester Stallone. And it broke my heart because they gave it heck. I mean, they were ragging on it bad. I enjoyed it.
All right.
But I think my guiltiest pleasure,
I
don't mind, Xanadu, Olivia Newton-John. Look at me if you want to, David. I don't care.
I'm going to need you to put down your headphones and exit the building right now, Johnny. Just
I can't give him a man card either because I'm a huge fan of the movie The Warriors as well. I watched The Warriors and Xanadu back-to-back one day.
Well, Xanadu has Olivia Newton-John, and at the time, she was some nice eye candy. She was pretty easy on the eyes, so you can't guilt her for that.
Isn't there, like, roller skating in that movie, too?
Yes.
Okay. All right, well, singing and roller skating?
The main reason I did them back-to-back is because the gentleman who played lead in Xanadu played lead in The Warriors.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So I did a little back-to-back showing someone these movies.
Okay.
What about you? Back to you, brother. Your guilty pleasure. Don't be smiling and blushing on me now. I just said Xanadu.
So, I the Pitch Perfect movies.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, see, you got something out of Haley now.
Yeah
both of them. Because when I was talking to Haley before we went on the air, and in high school, I was in choir, and I did...
I'm going to need you to take off your headphones.
And exit the building immediately. Oh. Hey, my three older brothers shredded my man card years ago, so I don't care about that. But I was talking to you, it's like during high school, I was in groups like that. I was in a cappella groups and swing choir and spring musicals and plays and dramas and stuff like that. And so that was my whole background. So when I talked earlier about my wife coming in and me watching a movie, it's usually if I can find Pitch Perfect or Pitch Perfect 2, my search is over. And I lay down the remote control and I...
Does it bring back memories for you? Or you?
Just being a group and being and singing and you know, collaborating together and putting together a routine. And the music is really, it's all a cappella versions of songs that probably shouldn't be a cappella, but they make it work, and it's really funny, and it's really entertaining. If you ever get a chance, you would be surprised at probably how...
Haley, you keep saying yeah with Pitch Perfect. Have you ever heard of Xanadu?
No, I'm sorry.
Okay, this was like years before you were even thought of.
But Pitch Perfect, that's some quality cinema.
Yeah. Xanadu was probably way before her parents were ever thought of.
No, it was an 80s movie. So, and you know how all those went, every single one of them. Ms. Haley, do you have a movie that is kind of shameful to admit that's one of your favorite?
I mean, it's not really shameful. I guess I wasn't going to say Pitch Perfect, but I guess that's one of them.
I kind of opened the door.
Well, for
I didn't really realize that was shameful, though.
You're welcome, Haley.
Well, for a man in his 40s, that's shameful. For an 18-year-old girl, it's not.
For a young 18-year-old young lady, you would be fine by saying Pitch Perfect.
Absolutely.
But.
I mean, I guess The Notebook, like... That's kind of just like an eye roll,
that's
course.
That's in your wheelhouse. If you'd have said something like, I don't know, Apocalypse Now or something, I'm like, that would be...
Yeah, Full Metal Jacket or...
We're naming movies she has no idea what we're talking about.
No, I mean, maybe that just means if Notebook is my worst one, maybe I just have good taste.
There you go.
Back at you there, Mr. Johnny Lyle.
Damn.
Yeah.
She just dropped the mic. She just dropped the mic.
Now, Haley, that's something I don't understand, the whole mic drop thing.
Really?
Anyone who's ever
mics are expensive.
Never paid for one.
Yeah, has never bought a mic. Right. That's the old comedy thing. If you drop a mic afterwards, usually A, very seldom should you, you know, has your performance warranted a mic drop? And B, you've never purchased a mic. Right, yeah.
But I'm going to tell you right now, the only place to purchase a mic is Sam Ash in Castleton.
Nice.
Sam Ash Music Stores. That's where we go.
You see what I did there? Just see what I did there, Johnny? Nice. Right into perfect. That one.
I'm impressed.
Nice.
David, what about you, man? Do you have a little shameful movie?
A shameful movie?
A guilty little
something
player.
You wouldn't want the fellas to know you watch on a regular
oh,
basis.
Oh, I don't really care. Dirty Dancing.
Oh, well, that's not too bad.
All right.
I mean,
Johnny Castle's a pretty tough guy, so
yeah,
that's not too
yeah.
bad.
I'm not gonna lie. There's a bunch of movies out there where I just sit down by myself and I watch and a tear rolls down my
These
eye.
These are J-Lo movies, aren't they? That's what they're doing.
I get happy when I see J-Lo movies, man.
The Jim and the Holograms? Well, it's Jim and the Holograms, isn't it?
No.
That's one of mine, actually. I'm not even kidding a little bit. I loved Jim and the Holograms.
Really?
You know what, man? I've got a 15-year-old daughter who spends all day in her room singing all day.
Sure.
I remember watching YouTube videos.
And you know, and I've tried to do that YouTube thing a little bit, and it's just like, I don't know, man. It just hit me in the heart a little bit. The other movie I can never not watch if it's on is Overboard with Kurt Russell.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know why. Man, if I admitted to seeing that movie 300 or 400 times in my life, I would be maybe not exaggerating. Like, I think I've seen that movie every time it's ever been on TV, on cable, and I don't know why. I mean, I love it, but I don't love it that much. I don't love it like I love Empire Strikes Back. I think I've seen it more than I've seen Empire Strikes Back, and my middle name is Jedi. That's crazy.
Hamilton 16 IMAX is where we are. It's movie night with JL Media. Tonight's movie is Deepwater Horizon, but as everyone knows, we discuss movies here, not just the one we are premiering. Good Rich Quality Theaters, Hamilton Town Center is where we're doing it live.
You know, you know, earlier we was talking about Ice Cube, how he transitioned from... musically from rap to the movies, and I think we can put Will Smith in that group, but most people don't know that Mark Wahlberg was musically inclined back in the early 90s himself.
I don't know about inclined, but he was musical.
I guess you can call it
his whole family was. Donnie was. And
Donnie was part of New Kids on the Block. Do you know New Kids on the Block?
Yes. Yeah,
okay. I don't want to alienate Haley here.
Oh, no.
But some people may not remember that Donnie actually tried to recruit Mark to be a part of New Kids on the Block.
Really?
But yeah. Yeah, when the group was first formed together, he was trying to get Mark into the group. Mark didn't want to do the singing and dancing thing. So when New Kids hit it off big, that's when he brought his brother into the musical family with Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch. And they did have that one hit wonder. God, I forget the name of it now.
Good Vibrations.
Good Vibrations.
Come on. Feel it.
There you
feel
go.
Feel the vibration.
It's just your good vibration.
Yeah, everybody remembers that.
And
that's when the whole phenom of Mark Wahlberg happened, because if you remember that, from there he went on to like model for Calvin Klein underwear, and you saw billboards.
That ad was inappropriate.
Absolutely.
And you saw billboards and commercials of him, and then he eased on into the movies. And I guess you can put him in that category as an Ice Cube or Will Smith.
Someone that made the transition
yeah.
from music to...
film,
right?
Yeah.
And made probably way more made way more money in movies than they have.
Exactly.
Right.
And now he's everywhere. Mark Wahlberg is everywhere.
He's so funny. I mean, in his serious roles, he's amazing. He's hilarious in his funny roles. I enjoy him a lot.
He seems like a cool guy, like in real life. Like,
just to hang out with
yeah.
and say, hey, how's it going? And he'd be like, oh, hey, Haley, hey, guys, you know what I mean? And he'd be like,
yeah.
He wouldn't be a snob or like a yeah.
I mean, from like Ted to Transformers, Entourage, you know,
exactly.
so forth and so on. I mean,
my favorite movies is Invincible that he was in when he
yeah.
played Vince Papali.
That movie's awesome.
That's
yeah,
a great
I
movie.
Love it. It's yeah.
I was just pulling up his movies here to see which his first one was.
I think it's Basketball Diaries with Leo DiCaprio.
Yeah,
that would probably be.
He's actually amazing in that, and I think that kind of like that was his star making thing as far as being in movies. He was really outstanding. He had a drug addiction.
Yeah.
That was a really cool flick.
Oh, wow. I remember he was in Renaissance Man. Remember that with Danny DeVito?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I completely spaced that. That was right before the Basketball Diaries.
I remember Three Kings. Ice Cube and George Clooney.
I'm not sure if you know this. He is currently filming the new Transformers movie.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yes, I do.
That's my Transformer sound effect.
Nice.
Quality.
Nailed it.
Yep. I just changed into a movie theater manager. Can you tell a difference?
Hamilton 69 Max. It is movie night with JL Media. We are sitting with the lovely Haley Jonay.
That's me.
You have the festival coming up, dear. You have a new album that you're working on.
Yeah.
Is there anything else you can let us know?
I don't know. Just constantly working on new music, writing, and working on making my live show kind of trying to cultivate this live show that just is consistently going to new levels and trying out new sounds and new genres and figuring out different sounds. You know, I don't know where I'm going with this.
I have a question for you. I mean, okay. Without, you know, giving away anything.
Yeah.
You're working on a new album.
Right.
And you write your own songs.
Yeah.
Take us through that process. Like, how did you come up with the idea of a song? Like, I guess the first question I have, what are your musical influences?
A little bit of everyone, honestly. Johnny Cash to Taylor Swift to Ed Sheeran to Alanis Morissette to the Beatles, John Lennon. I mean, everyone.
So
now, Marky Mark.
Yeah, Marky Mark.
Sure. Yeah.
So, since you write your own, yeah, take us through that process, like the ideas, or do you use those musical influence as ideas, and how do you start? Do you start with like a pad and a pen or a pencil or something like that?
I think it's just, for me, songwriting is kind of like a form of writing in a diary. Like, it's my way to chronicle my life and what's going on, and to kind of process different emotions and feelings and events that are happening. So for me, a song idea can happen anywhere. Like, one time I was in the middle of math class and I was like, ooh, that'd be a good lyric. And I wrote it down and ended up just writing a song in the middle of my class. Probably should have focused on equations. But
did you pass that class?
I did.
Okay, great.
Yeah,
okay.
So it's all good. But
Win-win.
Yeah, yeah.
It's funny the parallels, because I do the same thing with jokes. Mm-hmm. If I'm at a supermarket or wherever, I'll see something that's funny. And it may not be that funny, but I'll think I can make that into a joke.
Mm-hmm.
Or I can do, you know, whatever. So it's not like she said, you get the best ideas from the weirdest places.
Yeah.
And you're not even trying. It's just something happens and it's like, that could be funny. It may not be that funny now, but I can add to it and make it funny. She can add to it and make it beautiful. Make it, you know.
Well, speaking of weird places, where can we find you online, brother?
You can find. I'm on Facebook, just under Jeremy Brown. There'll be a nice picture of me and my lovely wife.
Do you put events out for your shows there?
Yeah, you can. Anytime I'm going to be on a show, it'll be on there. I have a Twitter address. I'm not really on Twitter that much, but it's FITNES_N_ER, Fitness Center, and so that's where I'm at. And so anytime if you want to look and see where I'm going to be at, it'll be there. So.
And Jeremy is a Hamilton County guy, so he is not the Jeremy Brown from the Marion County Police blotter. That is not him. I want to clear that up before you left tonight, brother.
Thanks for covering for me, Johnny.
My man. Haley, where can we find you online, darling?
Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all the social medias, at Haley Jonay, HaleyJonay. And www.haleyjonay.com.
Well, I'm glad you spelled it out, because most people can't understand my accent anyway. So thank you so much for helping me.
No, I mean, there's like 50 ways to spell Haley. Like, it's a lifelong struggle that I've had to deal with. So if I can make it easier for other people.
18-year-old lifelong struggle.
Yeah.
Jeremy, I got shoes that old, man. I can't lifelong struggle 18 years. You're a beautiful lady. You're very talented. Thank you for joining us, darling.
Oh, thank you for having me. This has been a blast.
And I was talking with your manager, and I heard that you agreed, so we got some things to talk about with Haley Jonay and JL Media coming up.
Yeah, the future's bright.
All right. David Banks.
Yes, sir.
We got some websites, brother. Throw them out there for us.
Well, first of all, you know, I'm part of Indie Drinking Dead. We're going to be in a new location this year for the new season of The Walking, season 7. Broad Ripple Tavern in the heart of Broad Ripple is a nice facility, bigger and better, people. So come on down October 23rd. Join us for the live viewing. You can look at us. Look us up.
Y'all picking me when I do.
I know, man. IndieDrinkingDead.com or look on the JL Media website and connect us through there. Also with Headline News, that's HeadlineNuz.com. Check us out there, myself and Angie Breyer.
The lovely Angie Breyer.
That's about it, man.
Once again,
when you said lovely, I thought you were going to say my name after that.
No.
Mitch Ross, the general manager at Hamilton 16 IMAX. You have a website up here, brother.
Yes, sir. www. I'll just say those W's because I like them. GoodrichQualityTheaters.com. I did have a correction, Johnny. I said something last week that wasn't true, if you can believe that.
Uh-oh.
I said we were bringing back Batman from 1966. What we're actually showing on October 10th is Batman Return of the Caped Crusaders, which is an animated feature done in the classic style, kind of emulating the show and the movie from 66. And they actually brought back the voice talents of Adam West, Burt Ward, and Julie Newmar. And it should be a lot of fun. But it's on October 10th at 7:30. So we are not playing Batman from 1966. We're playing something else. But it should be equally cool.
There we are. Thank you, Mitch Ross.
Bless your heart, sir.
This has been Movie Night with JL Media, Hamilton 16 IMAX. This is where we do it live at least once a month. Check us out at jlmediatoday.com. Thanks for joining in, guys.